Our next speaker is not only a luminary in the field of experience design, but a mentor whose influence has left an indelible mark on many aspiring minds, including my own. Mat Duerden is a distinguished author, educator, and a guiding force behind the world of experience design. Matt's expertise extends far beyond the pages of his books. He is a beacon of knowledge and inspiration for those fortunate enough to have been under his guidance. As a professor at BYU, he imparts wisdom on experience design, shaping the perspectives of future innovators. His mentorship has been a cornerstone in the journeys of many during their academic pursuits and beyond. Today, Matt graces our summit to share insights from his wealth of expertise. Get ready to be inspired and learn a lot of innovative ideas for you guys to take back to your organizations. My goal is that after a day and a half of incredible content, that right now you're going to really be able to dive into what problems are you facing in your organizations and what can we do to help you find solutions. So I'm so excited for you guys to get to experience the Mat Duerden experience. It's one that I am thoroughly a fan of. So please welcome to the stage, Mat Duerden.
Thanks, Paige. Can everybody hear me okay? Is the mic on? Are we good? Okay. That was like the nicest introduction. Paige, my goodness, I am just so grateful to be here. When I got Paige's call, I've done, came out and did a podcast a while ago with Bryson and just admired the work that happens here at Awardco. And I love getting off campus and the chance to talk with people who are looking for content that they need to apply tomorrow and that they're listening not just because they're wondering if it's gonna be on the test at the midterm, right? So I'm hoping today, and as Paige said, that we can give you some tools and workshop a little bit in a way that will allow you to synthesize some of the content that you've been gleaning over the last day and a half. I'll have to also say that I acknowledge and recognize that the after lunch afternoon slot is a tough one, right? As we begin to digest that really delicious lunch. So this is gonna be pretty hands-on. And we're gonna do a variety of activities that for some of you may feel really comfortable and others of you might push you a little bit out of your comfort zone, but not too far, hopefully. We'll do this in a helpful way. And we'll do some activities that at first might feel like, why are we playing with Lego? But I'm hoping to like make some connections and teach some principles that will be valuable to you. So instead of saying anything else, I just want to jump into our first activity. You need a piece of paper and something to write with. So there's stacks of paper on your tables. And this might require some of you to move around a little bit because you're gonna need a partner. And I'm gonna rely on Paige's team to maybe partner up with people if we have odd numbers. It's gonna work best if you have a partner to do this with, okay? And you need to be sitting next to your partner so you can look at your partner. So if you don't have a partner right now, raise your hand. If you don't have a partner, okay. And if you need to move, this is just a short activity, so if you have to move back, move from your table, you'll be able to move right back, okay? We were just gonna take a couple of minutes.
Can I move this to the
microphone? Oh, yeah, totally. Yes, yeah, totally. Can I wander around the stage, or do you need me to stand?
Or we can keep it here, but if you...
Okay, great, yeah. Can I just give this to you? Okay, great, perfect. Okay, I'm getting instructions of what I should do. Okay, anybody who doesn't have a partner, everybody find a partner? We good? Okay, here's what you need to do. We're just gonna jump right into this. And if I like say DJ play music, will like music come on? Is that a thing?
Yes.
Oh, yes, okay, this is awesome. Okay, here's what we're gonna do. You are going to do a blind, don't start yet. I'll tell you when to start because there's a time sort of stamp on this. You are going to do a blind contour drawing of your partner, okay? So, right, you're feeling awkward already. Here's what this is gonna do. So, anybody know what a contour drawing is? Somebody? Yeah, one continuous line. So whatever you're writing with has to stay on the paper for the full 90 seconds when I say go. The blind part is you can't look at your paper. You're just looking at your partner in the eye while you draw their face. And Okay. And you're both drawing at the same time, okay? So blind contour drawing, one line, you're both drawing at the same time. Any questions? Any questions? Just the face. Just the face, okay? Don't look at your paper and don't stop drawing. You've got 90 seconds. Cue the music, go. Go, start drawing. Start drawing. Oh man, you guys are good at this. Oh yes. Keep that eye contact. Okay, you've got 30 more seconds. Okay, go ahead and look at your drawings. Show your partner. Show your partner. Maybe hold them up so everybody can see. Oh, you guys did awesome. Good work. Good work. Okay. Okay, let me ask you a couple of questions. We're gonna do some audience participation here. And should we use this mic so everybody can hear? Or they already turned it off. I don't know how to work this. Okay, let me ask you a question. Somebody tell me, do you guys want me to bring the mic around or can you just talk loud? Okay, we've got a mic helper. Thank you. Paige, right? Okay, thanks, Paige. Okay, somebody, like, what type of emotions did you feel or thoughts were you having as you did this activity? We've got a willing audience member over here.
I was, like, very self-conscious because she's so pretty, and I was like, it's not going to look pretty, but, like, you're really pretty, so I apologize already. So super self-conscious and, like, wanting to do a good job and wanting for her to like what I produce, but knowing that it's going to be trash.
But well, I mean, in all honesty, the odds were stacked against you, right? Right? I sort of, like, set you up to not be able to do the thing that you did. Okay, one other comment right here.
So I really, really struggled with wanting to look at what I was doing.
Yes. Yeah. Why do you think you wanted to look?
Because that's going to be feedback. Like, it's either going to stink or it's not. And so I literally had to put my hand over it at one point because I did pick my pen up and I was trying not to cheat.
Good job.
Yeah.
Good job. Bonus points for her.
Yeah.
Whoever's keeping
bonus.
Track of points, she gets bonus points. Okay, awesome. So let's just talk about this briefly because this sort of sets the stage for what we're doing and also like a core aspect of innovation, right? Our brains like to create and they like to critique, and both of those are important functions. The issue is most of us try to do both of those things at the same time, right? Which really slows down the process of coming up with ideas. And the key secret to coming up with good ideas is to come up with a lot of ideas, which we'll talk about more as we go. But if you're continually critiquing ideas while you're also trying to create ideas, it just creates this like log jam. And we all do this, right? Depending on the team that we're working on, we may feel like, oh, I'm afraid how so-and-so will respond, or last time this got shut down, or like, no, I just want to bring my best ideas to the forefront. If we can get better at creating and then critiquing, because both are important, like to tease those two functions or processes apart, the better that we'll do. I don't have this on my slides, but there's a great book that came out last year called Idea Flow by Jeremy Utley, U-T-L-E-Y, is the first author. There's two authors, but if you Google Idea Flow, Jeremy Utley, he's a director of executive education at Stanford's Design School. And their book is just about this idea that the key business metric is the amount of ideas an organization can produce. and how much time that takes, right? So their metric, and they get into why they feel that this is the secret number, but about 2,000 ideas are needed to bring an idea to the market, right? And so the book is all about how do you just produce ideas? And part of the core piece is being able to create and then critique, okay? And so today, in the time that we have together, we're gonna focus on doing both of those, doing some creating and critiquing, and hopefully get to a place where you're able to synthesize and walk away from our session today with some ideas about how you can implement the information that you've been gathering while you've been here. And we're gonna use as our primary, look, I always lose clickers. Okay, here it is, I found it. It was in my pocket. The sort of our framework today is design thinking or human-centered design. How many of you by raise of hand are familiar with or have done stuff with design thinking? Okay, a handful of hands around the room. There's a lot of different flavors of human-centered design, design thinking, agile, sort of all have like similar ideas to them, but the basic core idea is that to solve problems or to seize opportunities, we have to make sure that we understand those problems and opportunities from the perspective of the people we're trying to work with or solve for, right? And if we do the work to really understand their perspective, we'll have a higher likelihood of actually solving the problem at hand as opposed to what we sort of think our version of the problem is. And then we go through a process of trying to come up with a lot of ideas and test those in prototype form that seem most viable to quickly learn and pivot. And it's as we ideate and or brainstorm and test these ideas that we can co-create solutions to meet needs, right? And so it's just an approach that we'll use today to try to do some processing of the information that you've gathered. And whether I'm teaching undergraduates or executive MBAs or audiences like this, this is one of the most helpful and generalizable frameworks that I work with in the consulting and teaching that I do. And it does require us to have like a bias towards action. Like we're gonna do a variety of activities and you're not gonna have enough time to finish them, right? And that's by design so that you get just comfortable with like sharing things that are halfway complete or ideas that are not all the way formed. Because the sooner we get feedback on things, the more quickly we can understand like what's working and what's not working and then just focus on the part that is working. So let's shift and think about. We already did this. That was the blind contour drawing. I decided to just kick us off with that. So the first piece of design thinking, and probably the most important, is the empathy stage, like trying to systematically gather information from the people we're trying to solve problems for or facilitate opportunities for. And so you all work in different companies. Working with people, trying to empower employees, and I would imagine you've got a pretty good sense of what are salient needs of the people that you're serving. And in this session, we can't address all of those needs, but I want you to, we're gonna go through a process to help you try to identify at least maybe a constellation of needs to focus on for the next hour and a half that we're gonna spend together. And I also recognize in talking to the team, Paige's team, that some of you are solo, some of you are with colleagues from the same company. So if you end up like collaborating across companies, that's totally fine, right? A little bit of cross-fertilization. So we'll just sort of see how this goes, and I'll let you like organize yourselves on your tables in ways that make sense for you. But in the little Tupperwares, there's some post-it notes. So if anybody wants to like grab one of those and make sure that everybody has a pad, a post-it note pad, because we're gonna start with the post-it notes to do a little empathy work. Now, ideally, we would have your employees here so that you could talk to them. But I imagine that this will work okay, and this is probably something that you do already in terms of trying to understand what the needs of your employees are. But I'm going to give you maybe 2 minutes to just individually write down things that your employees are thinking, saying, feeling when it comes to employee recognition in your organization, right? What are their current thoughts, needs, pain points, peaks when it comes to employee recognition and other sort of related topics? You know your space better than I do. But I want you to just put like one idea per post-it note down. And again, we're just creating at this point. We're not worried about, is this the most important one? If I worded it correctly? No, like just get an idea down on a post-it note, put it to the side, and then go to the next idea. And just make a little pile, right? And we're going to go for like 2 minutes and then do some sharing. Okay? Any questions about what I want you to do? Okay, let's do music and we'll go for 2 minutes. I love having a DJ. This is the best. I got to get... And yeah, don't worry about the quality or if this is the right way to word it. And if you get stuck on an idea, just like move on to the next one. You know, 30 more seconds. See if you can get maybe two or three more ideas down. What are people saying, thinking, feeling, peaks and pits when it comes to employee recognition in your organization? Okay, let's come back together. So what I want you to do now is to share the ideas. You can, actually at your tables, you'll probably need to make a decision if you all sort of are working together. I prefer people to not work individually because it's gonna be easier if you're working with somebody else. So if you wanna have like two groups at your table or however you wanna sort of divide up. But ideally, we're going to work towards having small groups working on sort of a similar issue. So you sort of decide at your tables how you want to work it. And that might come, let me just say this first before you start sharing. You can make that decision if you want to share as a whole table first, or if you want to share in small groups to start off. You know better your sort of groups than I do. Here's what I want you to do as you share, though. Go through and share those ideas and put them out. If there's a way for you to sort of create space where you could like combine your notes, sort of, so you've got some workspace in front of you. If somebody else is sharing and it sparks an idea, like put that down on a post-it note. Continue to generate ideas. Feel free to ask questions. When you're sharing ideas, I mean, you had 2 minutes to write these down. They're on post-it notes. This is not like final draft work. So you don't have to apologize for your ideas, though some of us feel inclined to do that at times. Just share your ideas and see if you start getting a sense if there's clusters, right? Like, oh, are like, yeah, we see sort of a cluster on this, the like this particular topic, but we'll just sort of see what emerges. So I'll give you like 3 or 4 minutes to share and compare and maybe organize your ideas a little bit, and then we'll check in and see where we are. Any questions? Okay, go ahead and start sharing. Back here, should I bring them like some supplies? Because I didn't put stuff on these back tables. Yeah, totally. Do we? It looks like this is the only of our back table groups. Just working. Oh, perfect. Okay, I'm gonna get them some Lego so they have some too. Okay. Do you want me to move this someplace else for you? Do you guys want me to move this? Is that in your way?
I think it's okay.
Is it okay? Okay. I don't want to ruin. Okay.
Do you want it, man?
Yeah, I was going to hold it up in front with me. I don't want to ruin your ambiance, but just so you can see each other. I hope I'm not overstepping my bounds, moving floral arrangements around. Do you guys want me? Is this in your way, like talking?
Yes.
It's okay. Okay. Let's go 1 more minute. I'll check in 1 more minute. Thank you. Let me just touch base here a second. I'll let you go back into these conversations. I just want to get a sense of where we are and give one other sort of task if you feel like you're far enough along. How many of you are still have people who need to share at your tables? Oh, we've got, okay, great. What I want you to do now, I think I'll have you do this and then we'll come back and talk as a group. So two things. One, sort of have a conversation if you haven't already, if you see any sort of common themes or if there's like sort of a primary theme that's emerged. And two, a common sort of design trick or approach is asking five whys, right? If you identify sort of a need or a pain point, you try to understand, okay, this is what we're seeing on the surface level, but can we get a little bit deeper, right? Because we, a lot of times, we'll sort of stay at sort of this surface functional level and we don't get a sense of like what are, like what's really driving this. So if you have some like clusters or primary themes that you've identified, I'd like you to just have conversations about like why, like what might be, is there something underlying this? Yeah, like employees, of course, like recognition is important, but for your employees, like why in particular? Is there a particular sort of flavor of why that's important? So talk about that. So primary themes, and if there's underlying needs that you think exist under some of these themes you've identified, and we'll come back together in like 90 seconds, 2 minutes, okay? Any questions? Okay, chat. Okay, do we have anybody who's willing to share sort of a primary theme that emerged in your conversations and perhaps just your brief thoughts about like, you know, this particular need or theme?
So I think underlying to like all of ours is like people not feeling recognized enough. Mm. So our conversation went back and forth between like, is it a manager not recognizing, is that the issue, or is the issue the value that people are placing on the recognition and not feeling that it's happening enough?
Okay, interesting, yeah. So there's like multiple reasons why that might be in, like on people's minds. Mm-hmm. Okay, great, thank you for sharing. Anybody else? You got one behind you there, Paige. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Yeah, so ours, we did like the why thing where we kept going deeper and deeper. Mm-hmm. And we're like, okay, it's because people are comparing. Why are people comparing? It's because they want external validation. Why do they want external validation? And the one that we got to right there at the end is that just people want connection. And it reminded me at a conference we were at a couple weeks ago, and they were talking about the Surgeon General for the United States and how one of the biggest epidemics that he is worried about is loneliness.
Yeah.
I think a lot of people are very lonely and they want connection, and recognition is a way to connect people. And so if they feel like they're not getting that connection, they're going to feel like it's missing. They're going to feel lonely.
Yeah, I love that. There's actually a theory called the social development model that looks at like adolescent socialization, and it speaks to this, right? Like adolescents connect with contexts where they feel recognized, where they feel they have competence, and where they feel they have opportunities to apply that competence and receive recognition for it. And I don't think that changes, right? As we grow older, we want to be connected to things. So I love how you dug a little bit deeper. Were there anybody else who wanted to share that I missed? Okay, right back here, Autumn's got one she wants to share.
I know, got you. And maybe you were kind of hinting at this, but for me, like when we kept asking those why questions, is I got down to like, I want to feel seen and like understood. Mm. And I mean, like a recognition means like, oh, like you get that I put in all that effort. Like you see that I have value. Maybe I am valuable. You know what I mean? And so when I kept digging down, it was just like, I think of hours that I spend at a company. I'm like, I'm giving more of my life to where I work than any other thing in my life, pretty much. So feeling understood and valued and seen the way that I want to be seen by a company to me is like everything.
I love that. And not just like seen like this is Autumn, this is the job title, but like as a holistic person, right? Who like is doing things that matter, right? And when you can get to these core needs, that's really, really powerful, right? Because needs, like basic human needs, don't change too much over time and culture, but solutions do. Solutions come and go. And when we fixate on solutions without understanding the need that's underneath them, we run into problems. For example, humans have had a need since the beginning of time to store and share information, right? And so whether we go back and the solution was cave paintings or oral stories or songs, and then eventually we had different ways to record language on clay tablets, and then the printing press came along, and then we had great big computers that filled up whole rooms, and now, you know, we've gone through floppy disks and zip drives and thumb drives and the cloud, right? And there's all kinds of stories of companies who have fixated on a particular solution and become obsolete over time because they were solution focused as opposed to need focused. And so taking the time to make sure that we're addressing the need that is most salient to our employees is really, really important. And to really double down on this idea, what we want to do is define the opportunity or the problem that we're focused on and really think about this as a story we're trying to tell about the particular issue, topic, need that we're addressing. And so we're gonna create at our tables, and this is where you'll decide like which groups are sort of working together, what's called a point of view statement. We wanna define the thing that we're focused on, the problem, from the point of view of the people that we're trying to solve it for, okay? And we're not articulating the solution at this point. This is another thing that's tricky, is most of us are pretty hardwired to see a problem and then jump immediately to solution implementation. Because there's a sense of like uncomfortableness when we know that something needs to be solved. But what can happen, and what often happens, is we end up solving the wrong problem, right? Because we haven't taken the time to really define what it is, especially define that from the point of view of the people that we're trying to solve it for. So if we take a little bit of time to just step back and say, okay, what is the actual problem that we're focused on? And the simple rubric or recipe for that is person plus need plus insight. So we're saying this individual or group of individuals has this need because, right? So it's like these people, employees at our company have a need to be recognized because they want to be seen, right? or they want to feel connected, right? And these will turn into almost more like paragraph statements as they're fleshed out, because once you articulate it, you take it back to those people and say, hey, does this resonate with you? Is this what you're feeling? Is this the actual need? And there's a development over time. We're not going to do that today, but what I do want you to do is pick one of the primary needs that you've identified and talked about, and turn it into on a single sheet of paper written large, so you can put it in the middle of your table, a point of view statement for an issue that you want to focus on, you know, for the next hour as we work together. So it may be all of your employees, it might be a subset of your employees. What is that need, and why is it important to them? Why is it salient? Okay? And we're just gonna draft some of these and then share, and that will be sort of our flag in the ground point from which we'll then start coming up with potential solutions, incorporating hopefully ideas that you've gained over the last couple of days. Any questions about the ask here? So identify the people that you're focused on, what is their need, and why is it important to them? And the more specific you can be, the better. Okay, but this is just a first draft, so don't stress too much about it. And if you're working on different things at your table, this would be your point where you're like, okay, the three of us are going to do this one, and us two are going to do this one. Or if it's everybody, that's totally up to you. But one piece of paper in the next like 2 minutes, have a draft done, and we'll go around and share some of these. Any questions? Okay, we'll go 2 minutes. Thanks for the music. Perfect. Yeah, so decide which groups are going to work. And just pick one of them. It doesn't matter at this point. It doesn't really matter which one, because we'll go through a process. And point of view statements don't have solutions in them. So you're not articulating how you're solving it. You're just describing the people and their need and why it's important. People need, and the insight, like why it's important. And you've got 2 minutes. 2 minutes to have something written down. We'll come back together in 1 minute. So try to get something down. Doesn't have to be perfect. Something down. So we can share a couple of these. And we're not articulating solutions yet, we're just focused on the needs. Okay, do we have maybe a a table or two or a group or two that'd be willing to share their point of view statement that they just crafted? Who's willing to share? This is a safe space. We're not critiquing, we're just creating at this point, so.
We said the leader is not engaged based on time and knowledge.
Okay, so you're focused on
leader.
The leader, and their need is they need to be engaged. But the insight you have is
lack
of time.
Time
okay.
and knowledge.
Okay, yeah. Awesome. Thank you. Round of applause for this great talk. I think there's a hand back here, Paige.
Okay, we said, as a hardworking associate, I need to feel valued so that I feel meaning in life and work.
Okay, cool. Okay, I like that you give some like description, like a hardworking associate, and then it's connecting back to meaning in life. One more over here.
So we're at a healthcare organization table. So okay. We identified our person as the frontline staff, and their need is to feel a sense of value or worth to connect back to their purpose. But an insight is they're tying their value to compensation that they're getting in the form of benefits and salary.
Okay.
And then a little bit of burnout tied in there.
Okay, I like it. I like it. Okay, so there's this element of like they need this sense of meaning, but it's like tangled up with extrinsic motivation around compensation. Okay, yeah, that's really interesting. Another way to think about a point of view statement is to think about it as a story, right? So another class that I teach in the BYU's Honors Program, they have these courses called Unexpected Connections, where they bring two faculty together from different disciplines and then they create a course. So I teach a course with my good friend, actually my next door neighbor. I'm gonna put this, I think there, can we get this up on these screens so the folks over here can see it? I mean, it's not like, and Lindsay, oh yeah, perfect, okay, great. I mean, this is not anything super fancy. But, so the course that I teach is called The Art of Transformative Storytelling, because my co-teacher and I really believe that storytelling competencies are ways that increase the likelihood that people are transformed by the experiences that they have. If you can tell stories to yourself and others about your experiences, it's much more likely that you're able to really be changed from what you experience in life, as opposed to just going from like one thing to the next and never actually like sort of breaking down and trying to decide like what's going on. And so I've taught this course for 3 years, we're wrapping up our third year right now. And what we've really come to focus on in reading a lot about storytelling and then teaching students and working through this process is good stories have three things, okay? They have characters that have specific needs that face complications as they try to meet those needs, and then they gain insights along the way, right? Those are the three like core pieces of a good story, right? And we listen to stories, we're hardwired to tell and listen to stories. And we love it when a story does these three things. If you think of any story that you love, it has characters with needs that face complications and then gain insights along the way. It doesn't always mean that their needs are met. Like sometimes the insight is like, oh, I'm never gonna meet this need because this need is more important. Or it might be a tragedy and they make decisions that you recognize as the listener or reader that they shouldn't have done that thing. But it's always about these. And a good point of view statement is the same thing. It's about people and their needs and why, trying to understand why those needs aren't being met and what it would look like if it was met for them, right? So that can be a lens that's helpful for some people to think about, okay, we're trying to really tell a story about our people and their needs and what are the complications they're facing along the way, and could we provide a solution that will turn into an insight of yeah, I do feel connection, or I do feel seen, or I can see how I can both be motivated by compensation and find meaning at work. Okay, so we've got point of view statements done. They're just drafts. Like I said, if we were doing this over an extended period of time, it'd be, okay, take these back to the people that they're about and see if you're on the right track. But even then, like the design thinking is often taught as like a linear process, which is what we're doing today, but it's just a set of tools. They're not meant to always be used 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It's just this iterative process of really trying to understand problems from people's perspectives and then go through a process of developing potential solutions and testing them and revising and moving through this process. So we're just gonna move forward into the ideate phase, right? Ideation, brainstorming, it's all the same flavor of what we're trying to do is come up with a lot of ideas. And there's a variety of models and double diamonds and things, but the main idea is we're trying to come up with a lot of ideas, so we diverge. There's a period of just creating, and then there's periods of critiquing and deciding like what ideas are actually gonna be the ones that we wanna test, right? Not like full out into the market, but just little scrappy prototypes to see if there's seeds of what might work in the ideas that we've come up with. And we create first without critiquing because the seeds of practical ideas often first emerge from impractical ideas. And if we shut the impractical ideas down too soon, like we'll never find that like nugget that could turn into something really valuable. Also, it's important to have a period of creation and coming up with a lot of ideas because we've got sort of our stockpile of like go-to ideas in our brain, whether we're aware of it or not. And if we're always just going to our top three or four or five ideas, we're probably not gonna get anywhere interesting. And if we're always just relying on ourselves to come up with ideas and we're not working with a team, it also decreases the likelihood that we're gonna come up with interesting things. So being able to create a team environment that's willing to define a problem and then tackle it in a way where people feel comfortable bringing their whole selves and their ideas to the table, recognizing, yeah, we need to critique these, but there's also phases where we just need to create, right? And when we do that, we're trying to be both fluid in our ideation, like, hey, I can just come up with a lot of ideas, but also flexible that we're coming up with a lot of different ideas, right? We're just not just a variation on the same theme, okay? Which is why diverse teams are so powerful. Whether that's different backgrounds or different functions within an organization, people who think differently are gonna create not only more ideas, but more different ideas, which also increases the likelihood of coming up with something that's actually gonna work. So what we're gonna do right now is, again, with the sticky notes, looking at that point of view statement that you've created, I want you to come up with as many solutions as possible, one idea per sticky note, right? And these, we use sticky notes and Sharpies because you can't like write very well, there's not a lot of space. It just forces you to be concise and get ideas down. We're gonna go through like three or four rounds of just coming up with ideas individually, and then we will share, okay? So you're gonna look at that point of view statement and think about, okay, what are potential solutions? If you find yourself critiquing as you go through, try to not do that, right? For some people, it's helpful to come up with like three crappy ideas to begin with. What would be the worst problem to solve or worst way to solve this, right? If that's helpful for you, you can try that out. But I'm gonna give you a time limit. We're gonna go a minute. We'll do each round a minute. And then I'm gonna give you some constraints as we go. So I'm gonna say, like, come up with ideas that are just sort of in this bucket or in this bucket. And I'll talk about why we're gonna do that in a little bit. But to start off, just individually, look over that point of view statement and just start coming up with ideas. One idea, next, next. Don't critique them, you're just creating at this point, okay? Solutions to your articulated point of view statement. This is where you can start like maybe mining some of the ideas that you've had in the sessions that you've attended already, okay? Any questions? Okay, let's go 1 minute individually. How many ideas that you can come up with to address your point of view statement? We're gonna go fast with this, so 1 minute. And if you run out of Post-its, like put your hand up and we can get you more Post-its, I think. One idea per Post-it. You're doing this just individually now. We'll share in a little bit. And like I said, if you get stuck, just like have one idea that's like, this would be the worst way to do this. That can like maybe loosen you up a little bit. Okay, for the next minute, I want you to come up with ideas as if you had like an unlimited budget. If you could throw like just gobs of money at this, what would you do? Okay, so like expensive solutions. Come up with expensive solutions for the next minute, okay? Still individual at this point. Expensive solutions. One idea per sticky. We're just doing 1 minute. Okay, last round. This is one of my favorites. The solutions have to involve robots somehow. Okay, don't worry about technology being like a whether this is viable or not. We're just brainstorming here. But like, I want you to come up with ideas that involve robots, because I like robots, basically. So ideas that involve robots. How could you involve robots in the solution to your problem? We're not worried about whether the technology exists that would power these robots. Don't worry about that right now. So your robots can do anything you want them to do. Robot solutions. Like DJ Roomba. Okay. Now I want you to share, and you're gonna have to go pretty quickly to do this, so don't give a bunch of preamble, don't apologize, don't try to tell a big story about your ideas, but quickly share ideas. If you have a similar idea, maybe cluster those, so you're sort of sharing and organizing. If somebody says something that sparks another idea, capture that and get it down. Your workspaces are getting like sort of disorganized, and that's okay, it's gonna get a little bit messy. Share, organize, and cluster. Okay, that's what I want you to do. We'll give you like 3 or 4 minutes, so you're gonna have to move pretty quickly. Go ahead and share, organize. Sorry. And it's helpful if you can all see each other's ideas. You've got 2 more minutes. 2 more minutes to share. You might have to move quickly. 2 more minutes. Raise your hand if your table still needs more time. Okay, we're gonna go 30 more seconds. Share quickly. 20 more seconds. Okay, sorry if I'm cutting off conversations. We're gonna move ahead so we can get to our other stages here. Let me just briefly talk about creative constraints. Even though we talk about creativity like anything goes and coming up with lots of ideas, research shows that we actually are able to come up with more ideas when we impose constraints, right? You can try this on your friends and, you know, say like name as many things you can think of that are in a kitchen. And then have another group of friends do the same thing, but say you can only name things that are white. And on average, research suggests that if we give that color constraint, people will come up with more ideas. And so constraining when we're ideating can be a helpful tool, whether that's time constraints, whether that's category constraints, it can be helpful. There's one other thing that I wanted to say about that, and now I can't remember what it was. Maybe it'll come to me later. We're going to do a quick activity that probably won't make much sense why we're doing it right now, but I'll explain afterwards, okay? We're going to have a rock, paper, scissors tournament, okay? And this is the way this works. Everybody's going to stand up when I tell you. You're going to stand up, and you're going to find somebody to challenge to rock, paper, scissors, okay? House rules are rock, paper, scissors, shoot, okay? Rock, paper, scissors, shoot. Best 2 out of 3, okay? If you win, you go find another winner and you challenge them, okay? But the important part is, if you lose, you become the biggest fan ever of the person who beat you and you chant their name. Can we get loud in here? Is it okay? Are we gonna get in trouble, Paige? Okay. So the chanting is important, okay? And then if the person who you're chanting for loses, you become a rabid fan of the person who beat them and then you chant their name, right? And then this progresses to like our showdown of two champions and then all of their fans chanting their names. Does this make sense? Everybody gets it? Okay. Stand up and start playing. Two out of three. Oh my goodness, our DJ is so good. This is awesome. Remember the chanting. The chanting is important. Okay, go find other people to play. Chant their names. Let's hear some chanting. Champions. All right. One more challenger right here. Let's hear the chanting. The chanting. Okay, this is our champion. Okay, let's give, what's your name? What? Carrie. Okay, Carrie, round of applause. Everybody have their seats. Okay, take a seat. Okay, that was awesome. Good job. Maybe Paige's team can find a prize for Carrie. Okay, Carrie's gonna get a special prize. Okay, so let's talk about this a little bit, beyond that it's fun seeing people chant each other's names. So usually in the real world, this is not how fandom works, right? Like when your team loses, usually don't immediately become a bandwagon fan of the other team, right? It's not how it works, which is fine. But we've also been in situations when we're working on teams and there's energy and we're coming up with our ideas, and then our idea isn't picked, right? And some other idea that we think, even if it's not our idea, the idea that we think should have been picked gets picked. And that can be deflating, right? At least I've had experiences where it's like, oh man, like I was really hoping we'd do this thing, but we decided to do this thing, so okay, fine. But the level of enthusiasm drops down. So we've experienced that. The reason why that is problematic is because it can decrease the buy-in of a team, right? And if a team is functioning well, and the goal is to come up with ideas, and also to continually iterate and revise and move forward ideas, it doesn't matter whose idea it was at the beginning. I'm hoping you've all been on a team where you work so seamlessly together that you forget who came up with the original idea, right? Because it comes through so many different changes and everybody's fingerprints are over it. So if we can remember to have this ability to pivot and get excited about ideas so we can still contribute and get our fingerprints on an idea as opposed to just pulling out and being like, oh man, my idea wasn't the one that got picked, right? In improv, we talk about the yes and principle, right? Did anybody remember the Office episode where Michael Scott does improv, right? Does anybody remember what he does, Maddie? He just shoots everybody every single time. In improv, the idea is like someone says, we're on the moon. You're like, oh, great, I'm so glad to be on the moon. But Michael Scott, he would just like shoot everybody because he was a detective in every scene, right? So the yes and principle is you take what's given and then you add to it as opposed to just like wipe it off the table. So we do this because I want you to actually pick, let's say, like a couple of ideas to move forward, to develop some very preliminary prototypes of. And the way we're going to do this, and this will be a little bit messy and isn't going to be perfect, but I'm going to give you each 4 votes, okay? And you can vote on any ideas except those that you came up with yourself. And the way you vote is just to do a little tally mark on the idea, okay? And we're just practicing here, so don't worry about, like, if you're not organized and can't see everything. But I want you in the next minute to sort of look at the ideas that have been shared and just use your votes, 4 votes, to tally up ideas, okay? And let's just see which ideas rise to the top from those that have been shared, okay? So organize however you want and then quickly vote. Everybody individually gets 4 votes, just tally marks you can use on ideas that aren't your own, okay? 1 minute to vote, let's do this quickly. And we're just practicing. Hopefully you capture all of these notes, but I want you to vote on at least a couple. Okay, raise your hand if you still need more time to vote. Okay, 1 more minute. Once you finish your voting, sort of pull out the top vote-getting ideas, and so you should have like 1 or 2 or 3 of your top vote-getter ideas that you want to pull out, because those are the ones that we're going to focus on, okay? Take pictures. It's good. I mean, you've got good ideas on your table just because they didn't get voted for, but we need a couple to work with for our next phase of the process. Okay, you've got 30 seconds, and we're gonna come back together and move on. 30 seconds. 30 seconds. We're gonna keep rolling here. You guys are doing great. Okay, so the hope is you've got a couple of ideas that at least right now we're gonna move forward. I'd encourage you to document, take pictures of these other ideas. It probably won't work as good in this setting, but Post-it has a free app. It's just called the Post-it app where you can take pictures of stickies and then they'll digitize them and you can like move them around and stuff. It's free too. We are going to create prototypes of the ideas that you created. Now, a lot of times we think about prototypes and like product development, but anything can be a prototype. And the purpose of a prototype is not to convince people that you're, it's not like something you're using to pitch an idea to sort of win support. It's to get feedback and try to understand like what works and what doesn't work. And feedback not just from your team, but from the people you're actually trying to solve the problem for, that you're actively co-creating solutions. And so we're gonna prototype today with Lego. And that's why there's some Lego on your table. And we're gonna start with just a quick activity. So there should be two bowls of Lego. If you need more, I can bring some more around. But we're gonna start with just a quick activity. Now, if you've played with Lego a bunch and you're like, oh, awesome, I love Lego, or if you've stepped on them as a parent without shoes on, or if you've never messed with them before, it doesn't matter, right? The basic orientation is the bumps go on top and then they stick together, okay? We're not worried about whether you're a Lego master builder at this point. But I am gonna ask you to build something right now, okay? So I want everybody individually to build a duck out of the Lego that you have available to you, and you have 60 seconds to build a duck. So you have your Legos in your kits, but you've got the little bowls of Legos on your table too. You can use those right now so you don't lose your Lego, but okay? So you've got the little Tupperware bowls that you can use. That Lego I'll need back. If you want to use your own Lego that you've been given, that's great. But individually, everybody build a duck. You've got 45 seconds. 45 seconds. Build a duck. Build a duck. Okay, everybody hold up your ducks so we can see them. Okay, oh man, you are as good at Lego builders as you are blind contour drawing people. Good job. Okay, let me ask a question. I want you to think about what image came to mind when I said build a duck. Like, what did you visualize in your head? Who's willing to share? Like, what was the image that came to mind? A rubber ducky. Okay, how many of you did like a rubber ducky? And what color was it? Yellow. Yeah, anybody have a non-yellow rubber ducky? Okay, a couple of other different colors. We're not gonna talk about tribalism, but we could go there too. This is like really like red rubber duckies? I don't know, like yellow rubber ducky people, come gather around me. What was your image?
I was thinking of an actual duck.
Okay, where was it? In a pond, okay? Who else like a real duck? And a real duck in a setting besides a pond, anybody? On the grass, okay. Okay, what other ducks were out? Oh, what was yours?
Duck hunting,
okay. Did anybody think of the Nintendo game Duck Hunting? No, okay, sometimes that happens. That's what you thought. Okay, the Nintendo game of Duck Hunting, okay, excellent. What, any other ducks that were out there? Just a mallard, okay, excellent. Cartoon ducks, we have like Daffy Duck, Daisy Duck, Puddles the duck from the University of Oregon. Any University of Oregon people in here? Oh, you thought of Puddles? Okay, Oregon duck. Okay, great. Okay, here's the reason we do this. And the reason why prototypes are important. When we tell somebody, even a simple thing like build a duck, we immediately, as humans, go in all kinds of different directions, right? We're all thinking like, oh yeah, we're like building a duck, but we're all doing something different, right? This becomes even more apparent when you say something like, let's talk about leadership or recognition. Immediately people are like, pew, all over the place. And you're all talking about the same thing, but you're not talking about the same thing. And when you're trying to develop ideas and develop solutions, this can become really complicated if all you're using are words to describe what it is that you're trying to talk about, right? Because if you're trying to get feedback about your idea and you're just telling people about it, what you're thinking and what they're thinking is probably not the same thing. So the feedback isn't going to be as helpful. And this is why building tangible prototypes is really, really important. Even if it's just a sketch, right? Even if it's just a sketch, that's better than just words. Like words plus sketch, not only do people retain and remember this more, but they're able to give more accurate and targeted feedback, right? And so the more that we can figure out, like, yeah, how do we just prototype this thing in a way? We want to change our recognition program in this way, but if we don't want to go like full bore and we don't have the budget yet, what's a way that we just test the concept, right? Beyond just telling people about it. I like to use Lego for a variety of reasons. One, they have high affordance, meaning you can do a lot of different things with Lego. And there's a bunch of research that the Lego Corporation has conducted on the connection between creativity and playing with Lego among kids, right? So about 20 years ago, internally, they started thinking about this idea of, could we use Lego internally with our own employees to promote creativity and use it as an innovation strategy? So a couple of business professors in Europe were brought in and worked with the Lego team and developed what they called Lego Serious Play methodology. They developed it internally at Lego for a number of years, spun it off into a nonprofit, and now there's a number of organizations around the world that do facilitator training in Lego Serious Play. I had a friend at Adobe here in Lehigh who they started using it, tipped me off. I went and did a facilitation training up in Canada, and it was really interesting, the diversity of companies that were there. I can't remember if it was somebody from Intel or Cisco, but they had a whole room of Lego where they had tens of thousands of dollars of Lego that they would use for different sort of purposes. And the main idea is that it's not about learning how to build things that look like rocket ships or dragons or whatever with Lego, but it's used Lego to convey abstract ideas, right? So, a green brick like this one could convey, profit, right? Or whatever sort of idea that you're trying to convey. And our brain is really good at layering meaning onto visuals, right? For example, let me give you just a quick example here. Thank you for the video screen here. Okay, so this is a squiggle. It's not anything, right? But if I go like this, and go like this, and like this, what is it now? Yeah, it's a cute little artsy bird, right? Does it look like a bird? No, it doesn't look like a bird, right? But I've added some triangles and some other things, and it's enough for the brain to say like, oh yeah, that's a bird. And our brain does the same thing with Lego or other sort of rudimentary prototyping tools. If we give enough signals that we can say, oh yeah, that is a duck. Or yeah, this is a model of, say, leadership, right? And there's also theory that suggests that when we build something, it changes how we think about it too, if we have to turn it into a real thing. And so the more that we can move ideas from our brains down into paper, into prototypes, we learn about our ideas as we prototype them, and then it also sets us up to be able to test and get feedback, which we're gonna do here in just a second. But first of all, I want you to build Lego prototypes of the top ideas that you voted on, okay? And this is gonna look differently for different groups, right? Don't worry too much about, like, does this look real? Just start putting bricks together, and your brain's gonna layer meaning onto them, and then you'll use that as a model to get feedback, okay? So I'm gonna give you 4 minutes to build a couple of prototypes of the top vote-getting ideas that you created, okay? So you can convey and share those to others. Any questions? I see people building. If you have questions, I'm happy to come around and talk. But just start putting bricks together to build prototypes. It doesn't have to, it could be an abstract representation or the real thing, but you've got 4 minutes to build your prototypes. You also have pipe cleaners. You can incorporate those if you want to, too. How many did you guys vote on? What were your top ideas? I like a million. I'd say like 2 or 3. Yeah. Yeah, just manage. You've got. You may just build one prototype, but if you want to build 2 or 3, that's fine. I'll leave it up to you. And that would be it for me. My heart's another absentee. Yeah. Left in the world, it's not the case. No one give a damn. But I'm trying to stick to Freud. I'm letting go and I fill that void with anything that I can show to prove. I'm not a waste of space. I don't need to be proud of me. I just want you to see what I can do to you. Okay, 3 more minutes. Okay, you've got 90 seconds. 90 seconds. Get pretty for the cameras. Just to know you're faking. For people you'll never know. On a first name basis. Strike a pose and count to 10. Cause you're gonna have to wait till then. Skip town with the car full of unfamiliar. Okay, so as I said before, we prototype to get feedback. And if we can go back to the screen up here, awesome, thanks guys. So the feedback is more precious than our prototype. We're not trying to defend our prototype, but we're trying to use it to get feedback to understand what works and what doesn't work so we can then pivot, make a new prototype, and move forward. Really, it's about thinking like a scientist, right? Has anybody read Think Again by Adam Grant? It's a great book. This is one of my favorite books the last couple of years. So in the book, Adam Grant, he's an organizational psychologist at Wharton, really prolific researcher and author, and he shares a bunch of his own research and others' research about how individuals and organizations who are willing to think again and rethink, especially their assumptions, are gonna be more successful, right? But we tend to sometimes act like politicians, where we're trying to like recruit support to our idea, or as preachers, where we're just sort of pounding the pulpit and trying to convince people of our idea, or prosecutors, where we're trying to tease apart and pick apart and deconstruct the opposition's ideas, where really we should think like a scientist, where we have a hypothesis that we're testing, and if it is proven true, great, and if it's proven false, also great, because either way, we learn something about how we can move forward. And so prototypes are just experiments to say what works, what doesn't work, and then let's move forward and iterate and change and test as we move forward. So what we're gonna do right now is we're gonna do a little bit of testing where you are going to share your prototype with either, if you have two groups at the table, great. If not, and you need another group to test on, then we might have to move around and we'll sort of figure that out. But ideally, you share your point of view statement and then you share your prototype and record feedback, right? Like, what do people think about it? And if you're being tested on, ask questions, give feedback, but we're just gonna do a quick round of testing so you can get some feedback on these prototypes that you created. So first of all, if you don't have a partner at your table that you can test with, raise your hand. Okay, so you guys need somebody. Do you guys need somebody to test with back there? You did different ones? But you need an outside, but you're all with the same organization, right? Okay, so you guys here, and who else needed? Oh, your table? Over, oh, these guys right behind you. Okay, so we're gonna let, oh, and you, maybe the three of you can go up, and you're our advanced group. You'll go just a little faster, okay? So we're gonna give you, we're gonna test for like 8 minutes, 6 minutes or so, right? So I'll give you like a halfway mark to change, and this group might need to go just a little bit quicker. Share your point of view statement, share your prototypes, give feedback, right? This is gonna be a little bit rushed, but it's gonna be okay. Okay, any questions? Okay, go ahead and share. If you need to move around, move around. Oh, yes. Prosecutor. Yeah. Okay, move, test, and record the feedback that people are giving you, right? This, you want to capture that feedback. Remember to share and then get feedback. We're doing the sharing so we can get that feedback. So make sure you're getting feedback too. If you haven't switched groups, you need to in about 30 seconds so multiple groups can share. Okay, we're gonna come back together in 1 minute. Okay, sorry to cut off conversations. We're gonna wrap things up and you can continue these later in the break. Let me, as we wrap up here, I just wanna say thank you for engaging in the process. You know, design thinking, I have a lot of faith in design thinking, not necessarily that you can like change the world in a 90-minute session, but this attitude of empathizing with people, doing the work to actually understand problems and opportunities from their perspective, working to come up with a lot of ideas that you critique and work through to try to understand which ones you want to prototype, and rapidly prototype, and being nimble and gaining feedback and being open to learn and pivot. I'm curious if anybody's willing to share sort of a piece of feedback or an insight that they gained about the problem that they were working on during our time together. I heard some clapping over here. I don't know what that was about, but let's go right here. Oh, and our microphone people are. Okay, great. Oh, interesting. Yeah. So this is another thing to sort of wrestle with and think through. Yeah. Yeah. Because you think about like what is an equitable need underlying childcare that other people who don't have children could be like, well, I have that need too. Yeah. And then you're meeting this need and not just this sort of functional visible need. Yeah, that's really interesting. What was the clapping about over here?
Oh.
Okay, yeah, impressive. Okay, did you guys learn anything from sharing that would be worth sharing with the group?
We were a lot better at Lego than we thought we were.
Okay, there we go. I love it. It's a valuable insight, right? Yeah, totally, totally. I love it. So I would encourage you to document these ideas that you gained. I also, this QR code up here takes you to a very simple Google Doc that has a couple of hyperlinked references. So there's a short reading on design thinking. There is, what else did I put on that? There is a link to a short piece that I wrote about the difference between genuine curiosity and counterfeit curiosity, because sometimes we pretend we're curious about people's needs and we actually aren't because we just want to like solve it and jump in. There's a link to my book, Designing Experiences, that talks about the role of human-centered design in the design of experiences, and something else, I can't remember. But I wanted to leave you with a couple of resources. And also, this is my email, so if you have questions or follow-up things, I'm happy to connect and follow up on anything. But you guys were great. I really appreciate the time and the invitation from Paige and her team to come out and chat, and I hope you have an awesome rest of the summit and safe travels home. So thanks, everybody.